was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the sun away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the world and never end. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, every fear is gone. I know he holds my life, my future in his hands. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the world and never ends. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen.
Well, hello, everybody, and welcome to Live with Lon this wonderful Easter Sunday, and I'm so excited to be bringing you a message on this Easter weekend. And what do we say? I say the Lord is risen. You say he is risen indeed. So let's start with that. Ready? I'm going to do my part. You do your part. Ready? The Lord is risen. Come on. He is risen indeed. Let's do one more time. Ready? Come on, nice and loud. The Lord is risen. He's risen indeed. Amen. And he is. Now, we are going to talk about the resurrection today from the Bible, because that's what we always do. The Bible, the whole Bible, nothing but the Bible, and then we apply it to our lives. But before we do, let's pray. Lord Jesus, what a privilege it is for us to come together this Easter weekend and to celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, the firstborn from the dead, as the Bible calls him, for coming back from the grave. And Lord, and we worship you, we love you, because your resurrection confirmed and completed our plan of salvation. And Lord Jesus, it confirmed for us that we're not following hoaxes or cons or made-up myths and legends, but we have followed the true and living way to Almighty God and to heaven and to eternal life. So as we celebrate the resurrection today, remind us, Lord, that we're to celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus every day. He's alive every day, but today's a special day. So use your word in our lives, we pray. And we ask this in Jesus' name, and everybody said amen. And what? Amen. Okay. Now, it's interesting that the resurrection was no closely held secret in the land of Judea at the time of Christ. Let me show you some verses. First of all, Matthew chapter 12, where to his enemies, the Lord Jesus predicted the resurrection. Look, for as Jonah, verse 40, was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights, so the Son of Man, that is the Lord Jesus, will be in the heart of the earth for 3 days and three nights. The Lord Jesus also predicted the resurrection to his friends, his disciples. Look at Matthew 16, verse 21. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and be killed and be raised to life again on the third day. Jesus predicted his resurrection to the crowds. Look at John chapter 2, verse 18. Jesus said, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it back up." Then the crowd said, verse 20, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple," talking about the literal temple in Jerusalem, "and you will raise it up in 3 days?" Verse 21, but Jesus was speaking of the temple of his body. And as a matter of fact, as Jesus hung on the cross, his enemies taunted him with what these words saying, Matthew 27, verse 40, "You who are going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, come down from the cross and we will believe in you." And finally, when the rabbis went to Pontius Pilate to ask for Roman soldiers to guard Jesus's tomb, they said, Matthew 27, verse 63, "Sir, we remember that when he was still alive, this deceiver said, 'After 3 days, I will rise again.'" My point is that everybody in Jerusalem and Judea knew full well Jesus' claim that he was going to rise from the dead. The question is, did he? Did it happen? Did it really take place? Well, I have four pieces of compelling evidence that I want to give to you today that the resurrection really did happen. Compelling evidence that after we're done makes it impossible that he didn't rise from the dead. So, let's listen up. Here we go. Compelling piece of evidence number one is the evidence of the Roman soldiers that were put there to guard the tomb. Let me show you Matthew chapter 27, verse 62. "Now the next day, which followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees, the rabbis, gathered together to Pilate, saying, 'Sir, we remember while he was still alive, how that deceiver said, After 3 days, I will rise. Therefore, command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night, steal him away, and say to the people, He has risen from the dead. So this last deception will be worse than the first.' Pilate said to them, 'You have a guard. Go your way, make the tomb as secure as you know how.' So they went and made the tomb secure, sealing the stone and setting the guard." Now, a Roman security team like this consisted of 15 enlisted men and one officer, and these soldiers had a vested interest in making sure that nothing happened to the body of Jesus. Because at the time of Christ, if you lost your prisoner as a Roman soldier, you lost your life. They took your life in exchange for your prisoner's life. Do you remember in Acts chapter 16, when the apostle Paul and Silas were in jail in the city of Philippi in northern Greece, and the gates sprung open as they were singing hymns one night, and the jailer, who was a retired Roman soldier, thought all the prisoners had escaped, and the Bible said he was about to fall on his sword when Paul said, "Do no harm to yourself, We are all still here. Why was the man going to fall on his sword? Well, because he knew that the magistrates were going to kill him once they discovered the prisoners had escaped, so he thought he'd save them the trouble. Now, the prisoners had not gone anywhere. They were still in the jail. You say, why not? Hey, man, ha! Somebody blows the doors open while Paul and Silas are praising God. You don't go anywhere till Paul and Silas move. You just stay right where you are, and that's what happened. Paul and Silas stayed, so the prisoners stayed. But my point is, these Roman soldiers sent to guard the tomb of Jesus understood if something happened to the body of Jesus, they were going to lose their lives as a result. And so, do you really think, entrusted with this kind of responsibility, accountability, and threat to their own lives if something happened to the body of Jesus, you really think a bunch of unarmed fishermen and women are going to get by this detail of Roman soldiers, battle-hardened Roman soldiers, and steal away the body of Jesus? I mean, come on. Impossible. Impossible. So impossible that it's preposterous. Now, compelling evidence number two is the evidence of the rabbis. I want you to look at chapter 28 of the Gospel of Matthew in verse 12. When the rumor, the news that the body of Jesus was gone and that he had risen from the dead began to spread through all Jerusalem, the rabbis were determined to squash this with everything that was in them. Look at chapter 28 and look with me, if you would, at verse 12. The rabbis, and when they had assembled with the elders and taken counsel, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers, saying, tell people his disciples came at night and stole him away while we slept. And if this comes to the governor's ears, Pontius Pilate, we will appease him and make you secure. So they took the money and did as they were instructed. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day when Matthew wrote his gospel. My point, however, I mean, they said, we'll make sure Pilate doesn't kill you if you tell people that you were sleeping and the body was stolen. The point is, they collected all this money and gave it to these soldiers, and they committed themselves to whatever it would take to convince Pilate not to kill these soldiers. Now, let me ask you a question. Why would these Jewish leaders go to all this trouble and all this expense? Folks, all they had to do is produce the dead body of Jesus. All they had to do is bring the body of Jesus and walk it on a cart through the streets of Jerusalem and show people his dead body, and everything we think of as biblical Christianity would have stopped in its tracks right there, right there, right there. Would have been over. So why didn't they do this? Why did they instead spend all this money and all this? Because they didn't have the dead body of Jesus. Where did the dead body of Jesus go? And we already said it's preposterous to think that the disciples of Jesus and his women followers actually could get by these Roman soldiers and steal the body. So if they didn't steal the body, where did it go? Why wasn't it there for the rabbis? All they had to do was open the tomb, pull out the rotting body of Jesus, put it on a cart, push it through the city, the whole thing's over. Kaput. Why didn't they do it? Because there was no body of Jesus. He rose from the dead. That's why. This leads us to compelling piece of evidence number three, which is the evidence of the eyewitnesses. Look with me at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3. For I delivered to you, Paul says, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. This is the gospel that Jesus died for our sins according to the scriptures, was buried, and rose again the third day according to the scriptures. That is the promises, the messianic promises of the scripture. All right, now look, and verse 5, that he was seen by Cephas, Peter, and then by the 12 disciples. And after that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present day, but some have fallen asleep. They've died. And after that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles, and last of all, he was seen by me also. Where did Paul see him? That's right, Acts chapter 9, on the road to Damascus. All these eyewitnesses saw the living, risen Christ. And so Paul says, most of these people are still alive as I'm writing this in roughly, 55 AD. Most of them are still alive. It was only 20-some years ago. Go ask them if you don't believe me, is what Paul is saying. And Paul says, I saw him too. Now, friends, one or two eyewitnesses could be wrong. But 500 who all saw the same thing, they were not all on any kind of hallucinogenic drug or something and hallucinating. They all saw him. Some of them touched him, as we read in John's gospel. Touched his resurrection body. You know, my middle son Justin is a lawyer out in California. And when he was in law school, of course, he had to take a course on evidence. And one of the older books, this isn't one I don't think they use anymore, but one of the classic books on evidence is a book called Phipson on Evidence. And in this book, we are told that one or two eyewitnesses are important, but today there is a movement away from eyewitness testimony because so often the one or two witnesses will disagree on some details. But folks, this is one or two witnesses. We're not talking about 500 witnesses to something that all saw the exact same thing. That is overwhelming. As a matter of fact, I won't bore you with the details, but if you're a mathematician, you can look them up. Let me put it up on the screen. The name of it is Bayes' theorem. And what this theorem says, to make it very simple, is that the greater the number of eyewitnesses who agree to a certain event, the greater the probability is that the event really happened. Now, that's just common sense, right? But this fellow Bayes actually put it into a theorem, into a mathematical formula. And in an article that he wrote, and I'll just put the title of the article up, you can go read it if you want. It's called The Bayesian Analysis of the Cumulative Effects of Independent Eyewitness Testimony for the Resurrection of Jesus Christ. Woo! What a title. And a fellow named Dr. John DePoe from Western Michigan University wrote this article. And let me read you his concluding statement. And I quote, let's put it up. From the New Testament, one can count as many as 520 eyewitnesses to the resurrection of Jesus. Given such a number of independent witnesses testifying that an event occurred, the probability that this event did indeed happen goes up exponentially and becomes, look at this, close to certain, end of quote. Wow. Close to certain from a mathematical probability point of view. Now you say, all right, Lon, I hear what you're saying. But you know what? All 520 of those eyewitnesses could be lying. I mean, all 520 of them could have gotten together and decided that this was the story they were going to tell, and hammered out the details so every one of them told the same story with the same details, making this one huge hoax, one huge con. Isn't that possible? Well, I would say to you, no, it isn't. And that leads us to compelling piece of evidence number four, and that is the evidence of the eyewitnesses' martyrdom. Friends, I hope you know that virtually every eyewitness to Jesus' resurrection that the Bible mentions right here in 1 Corinthians 15 and other places, virtually every one of them gave their life as a martyr rather than deny the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Apostle James was killed by Herod, Acts chapter 12. Stephen was martyred in Jerusalem, Acts chapter 7. Thomas was martyred in India. John Mark was martyred in Egypt. Philip was martyred in Turkey. Matthew was martyred in Ethiopia. The Apostle Paul was beheaded in 66 AD by Nero at the third milepost on the Ostian Way. And Peter was crucified upside down, according to Eusebius, the church historian, because he told Nero, same year, 66, that he was not worthy to be crucified in the same position of the Lord, so he wanted to be crucified upside down, and Nero obliged him. The only apostle that wasn't actually martyred was the Apostle John, but he was persecuted and exiled to the island of Patmos. And so all of these guys paid heavily for their unwillingness to deny the Lord Jesus Christ was resurrected. Now listen, if you're running a con, somebody flips when people start enforcing penalty on you, whether it's torture or suffering or prison terms or whatever. I mean, how many, you've watched Law and Order. People flip. That's normal. Some of us remember the Watergate controversy where John Dean, the lawyer for President Nixon, flipped. He said, I was okay when it was working, but I'm not going to jail for this. I'm going to turn state's evidence. This is human. This is normal. And you mean to tell me with all these eyewitnesses that if there was a hoax going on here, that every single one of them would have not flipped and virtually all of them named in the Bible would die rather than deny the resurrection was true? No, I'm sorry. This is completely not in keeping with human nature. No, just can't be. Somebody would have said, hey, I'm not going down with the ship here, fellas. But nobody did that. Why? Because this was not a con. This was not a hoax. It was not a lie that they all got together and made up. They all saw the risen Lord. They knew he had risen, and they believed it with all of their heart. So, what are our four pieces of compelling evidence for the resurrection? Number one, the evidence of the soldiers guarding the tomb who would have lost their lives if the body of Jesus escaped. Number two, the evidence of the rabbis who went through all of these shenanigans to deny the resurrection instead of just parading Jesus's body through the street because they didn't have Jesus's body. It had risen from the dead with the Lord. Number three, the evidence of the eyewitnesses, whom Bayes' theorem says makes this almost a certainty that the resurrection is true. And finally, number four, the evidence of the eyewitnesses' martyrdom, where every one of these guys gave their lives rather than deny the resurrection, because it wasn't a hoax they were running. The resurrection was true, and they knew it. Now, having done all of that, let me just say, can I prove to you like I can prove that 2 and 2 is 4, like I can prove in a test tube that hydrogen and oxygen make water? No, I can't prove it like that. But can I give you such a preponderance of evidence for the resurrection that even Judge Judy would find in favor of me? Well, not only can I just did. Praise the Lord. Can I get a praise the Lord out there? Come on now. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So, what's the conclusion here of all of this, this Easter weekend? Hey, it's very simple, friends. Remember the awesome promise that the Lord Jesus Christ made us as his followers regarding the afterlife. John chapter 11, verse 25, he said, "He who believes in me shall live in the afterlife, even if he dies here on earth." What a promise! But you know, Buddha, Confucius, Muhammad, Joseph Smith, all these people, L. Ron Hubbard, make great promises about the afterlife. Hey, how do we know they're not right about the afterlife instead of Jesus? It's very simple, friends. Who rose from the dead and who didn't? Buddha didn't rise from the dead. Joseph Smith didn't rise from the dead. Muhammad didn't rise from the dead. Confucius didn't rise from the dead. L. Ron Hubbard didn't rise from the dead. Mary Baker Smith didn't rise from the dead. Nobody rose from the dead. No rabbi rose from the dead. But Jesus rose from the grave. Praise the Lord. And you know what? I love to say it. Follow a dead Savior like all these other people, and you'll end up just like them. But follow a living Savior. We don't have a dead Savior. We have a living Savior. Follow a living Savior. You'll end up just like him. Remember what he said. Let's put it up again. John 11, 25. He who believes in me shall live in the afterlife, even if he dies here on earth. Wow. I'm going to hook my wagon to the Lord Jesus Christ for my eternal destiny. And I hope you'll hook your wagon to the Lord Jesus Christ for your eternal destiny. I mean, it's like going into this massive room with doors all the way around it. And each one of these doors claims to be able to take you to heaven and give you eternal life. And at every door but one, there's a skeleton pointing at the door. And at one door, there's the living, risen person of the Lord Jesus Christ pointing at the door. Which door are you going to go through? You're going to pick one of the doors with a skeleton pointing at it? I don't think so. You're going to pick the door with the live, risen Christ pointing at it. And I hope you've done that, my dear friend. I'm going to give you a chance right now. If you've never trusted what Jesus did for you on the cross, shedding his blood to pay for your sin, if you've never trusted that with all of your heart and all of your soul, and nothing else, not your good works, not your religious activity, not being confirmed or being baptized or being bar mitzvahed or anything else, but just what Christ did for you on the cross, and then his rising from the dead to prove to you that that was the price that God would accept for your sin and my sin. That was the price that God would accept and grant us eternal life in heaven in its place. Hey, it's time to do that right now. So let's bow our heads and pray. And with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray a little short prayer where all you're going to do is basically tell God that you are giving up today everything else you ever trusted to get you into heaven. And instead, you are going to embrace what Jesus did on the cross, dying to pay for your sin, rising from the dead to prove his payment was accepted and that it was efficacious for your eternal life. That's what we're going to do. So let's pray. I'm going to pray one phrase at a time. You pray after me out loud or to yourself, whichever you prefer. Lord Jesus, I come to you today because I want eternal life. I want to go to heaven when I leave here on earth. And so today, I give up and reject everything I've ever trusted to pay for my sins and get me into heaven. And instead, I transfer my trust for eternal life in heaven onto the work of Jesus on the cross, shedding his blood to pay for my sin. I thank you, Lord, for the resurrection, which proves beyond a doubt that Jesus' way is the one way God will accept and the true path to eternal life in heaven. Today, Lord, I embrace Jesus as my Savior from sin and hell and my Lord. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. And everybody said, what? Amen. And what? Amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer with me, or if you didn't, but you know what I'm going to say, you thought about it. That's right. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to Lon Solomon Ministries, and I want you to listen to my tape series or my message series entitled Spiritual Boot Camp. You know what boot camp is. That's what, you know, when you're a brand new recruit. Well, if you're a brand new believer, then you need spiritual boot camp. And I go over everything you need there. I go over why the Lord Jesus and the Bible and why we can count on the Bible and eternal security and why you can't lose your salvation and the whole thing. And I encourage you to listen to Spiritual Boot Camp 3, 4, 5 times over and over so that you really get all of the information out of it. Spiritual Boot Camp, and then find yourself a good church, a gospel preaching church, a Bible teaching church where they study the Bible, the whole Bible, and what? Nothing but the Bible. And then they apply it to your life and everybody's life that's there. Hey, God bless you. Let's close by saying, you ready? The Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. And I'm so proud of all of you that prayed and asked the Lord into your life. Spiritual Boot Camp. And Lord willing, we'll see you next week. Happy Easter. Praise the Lord on Live with Lon.